Hello, folks. This is not Indiana Jones. It's just that, okay? And this is Roy Humphreys, the Rowland Heights Gazette and the Rowland Heights Advocate and everything Rowland Heights and the Rowland Unified School District. Yes, we're out there for you. And what we have for you is a video of the January 26th, that's today, meeting of the joint meeting of the Rowland Unified School District School Board and the Bond Oversight Committee, which was an independent committee, by the way, to get up to speed so they all are on the same sheet of music regarding the Brown Act. You know, under the Brown Act, in a nutshell, is legislation came forward to assure that these government agencies don't do the, you know, the smoke-filled rooms and the, you know, the behind closed doors deals, so forth, and so that the public also gets a chance to participate. And so the endeavor here is to let you get you in on the same sheet of music so you don't have to be intimidated. Oh, this is a violation of the Brown Act. You can be as knowledgeable and as smart as they are. Okay? And it's your community, it's your school district. So get informed and get out there and participate. And to that point, after the meeting, I went to talk to a couple of the bond oversight people, because that is kind of a tender issue. This, now, there's been so many grand jury and probes and investigation in Fresno. The feds are in on it, and they're having to hire criminal defense attorneys, for gosh sake. This is a bond oversight committee school district. Yo, it's terrible. You know what I'm saying? And so I talked to Ms. Wendy Jung, and who's kind of been a distance there, but this is a new group. Three people left. And, you know, this organization has a reputation of being the proverbial rubber stamp. There's a per Ted Ebbenkamp and others that it's gotten around, so that a lot of people won't even bother to be, because they don't want their name and their social position associated with a proverbial rubber stamp, especially given the light of things that are happening now. And we have a new person on board, and this Moreno, who, you know, when first approached us, I said, give him kind of say, hey, just keep him posted, what's going on, anything I do for you? And she said, I'm going to try to get you guys some money. You know, you guys, this is a lot of work, and especially given the situation, it's like a full-time job. And she said, oh, where are you going to get the money? Well, hey, they pay the commissioner there $50 a month. They can give you guys $50, you know. He said, oh, conflict of interest. Well, yeah, okay. We'll work on it again. And she said, well, I don't do it for the money. This is my community. And I say, wow, where has she been for 16 years? It's 2016. First bond issue is 2000. Whoa, where's she been? So we've gotten this rubber stamp thing nipped in the bud. You know what I'm saying here? And she said, it's my community. And I said, gosh, can we clone her and do it in perpetuity? So, hey, the Bond Oversight Committee would never be of the its past history's reputation, et cetera. This would hope so. Okay, we got to do some cloning here. These new guys, as we said, it's a new group of people. Well, we won't go there because we don't make anybody feel bad. Politically correct. Okay, so watch the video. You will be as knowledgeable as anybody, and don't let anybody abuse you. Okay, and they can't abuse you if you got the knowledge. Okay, so you enjoy, and we'll be talking to you later. Bye.
Okay, this is January 26th, 2016. I have a combo of the
Rowland Unified School District Governing Board, the Citizens Bond Oversight Committee, and the Personnel Commission to order at 4:03 p.m. So, Dr. Mitchell, can you do the Governing Board's roll call, please?
Sure. David Malkin?
Present.
Donna Friedman?
Here.
Carrie Chen?
Here.
Lynn Ebbenkamp?
Here.
Antonina Fry?
Here.
All board members are present.
Thank you. And...
so would you call your meeting to order?
Okay, I won't be able to call my meeting to order because there is no quorum of our three. We have it because Judy is not officially on, and Sabrina Lee is out of town right now, so it's just me, and I appreciate the invitation, but there's no meeting for me to call.
All right, then we will have you, Sharon Fernandez as our guest.
Thank you.
And now we have the citizen body oversight committee.
Yes, thank you. Okay, well, we also don't have a quorum, so we can't call our meeting to order, but I guess we'll do our roll call, which is Harry Peterson is here, and Robert Alvarez is not here, Natalie. I know that your Carlos Sanchez is here.
Here.
My phone is not, and Wendy, so he's not here. So, if we can't adopt the minutes of the meeting here. So I guess we could do a flag salute.
I take care of that, but first I need to just invite you, Harry Peterson and Carlos Sanchez as a guest to our meeting then, since you do not have a quorum tonight.
Okay, thank you very much.
So next we'll move on to adopt the agenda. So I need a motion from the governing board to adopt the agenda for tonight's special board study session. Okay, we have our first by Donna Friedman.
Second.
Second by Lynn Ebbingham. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Next we'll have the flag salute. Yes, I'm leaving the flag salute. Place the flag, right hand over your heart. Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Next, we'll have a written request to address the board, the governing board. Note, remarks are limited to 3 minutes unless extended further or limited by the vote of the board. A maximum of 20 minutes unless extended by the board is allocated for each subject discussed. Ordinarily, board members will not respond to presentations and no action can be taken. However, the board gives the direction to staff following a presentation. Laura Humphreys?
Here. Okay, I'm Roy Humphries, and congratulations to the group. As an American poet, Bob Dylan says, the times are changing, and I'm happy to see that as a puppy at the mealtime here, the District and the Bond Oversight Committee getting together for long overdue training on the subject matter, and also to be recorded so that in future we can just play it for persons if they want a refresher or so forth. Yes, the times are changing, as evident by the grand jury probes of Los Angeles, Contra County, Fresno, and Solano School Districts. A special note has been given that the federal probe into Fresno's situation and Fresno hiring of criminal defense attorneys, as well as Los Angeles said to be in that camp. Costa County School District there has established a fraud hotline after a forensic audit. It's assumed that most, soon all attendees of this group will become intimately familiar with the findings of those grand jury situations, and note the hue and cry for a forensic audit of Rowland Unified is long-standing and painfully needed. Recent history is replete with the exposure of wide range of government bodies, to include West Covina and Pasadena, where long-term misfeasance, malfeasance of office, and betrayal of public trust was business as usual. Yes, those government bodies passed audits for decades. To the question of criminal prosecution in the state of Florida, a police officer was not charged for the homicide of the citizen, but criminal prosecution is being pursued for the breach of oath of office and betrayal of public trust. Yes, the times are changing. And as Walter Bergman states, as long as the empire can keep the pretense alive that things are all right, there will be no grieving and no serious criticism. And Frank Abagnale, if you can remember from Catch Me If You Can, states fraud is terrorism and getting worse. And in closing, for the Bond Oversight Committee and the board, that the navigation of the Bond Oversight Committee's aspect of the website is a nightmare. And one last item for on the legal side of things, that 182A5 California Penal Code, to commit an act injurious to public health, public morals, or to pervert or obstruct justice or the due administration of laws, is a misdemeanor punishable by 1 year in jail and a $10,000 fine. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Hutchinson. Next, we'll go back to Mr. Peterson. You seem to have a quorum now.
Thank you. This will do a roll call. Okay, we call the meeting to order. Okay. And do a roll call. Yeah. Terry Peterson, and I'm here, and Gilbert Alvarez, Natalie Marino,
present,
and Carlos Sanchez,
here,
Mike Long, and Wendy Song,
here.
Okay.
Terry, can you take a motion to call your meeting to order?
Okay. Pardon, I need a motion to, from the meeting to order.
I'm second.
Okay, so the meeting's called to order.
And then a vote.
Okay.
So all in favor?
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
And we need to make a, somebody needs to make a motion.
It's good.
To accept the agenda.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. I so moved to accept the agenda.
Aye. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So the agenda has been accepted.
Thank you, Mr. Peterson.
Thank you.
Next, we'll get started with our presentation, so I'll turn it over to Dr. Mitchell.
Perfect. Thank you very much. So the purpose for our meeting this afternoon is to bring all of our groups together to have some information on the Brown Act. The Brown Act is what governs our meetings, and it has been a request of CBOC as well as the board to have this, and of course we would want to always include our personnel commission as well. And so I have invited Barbara Ginsburg. Barbara's an attorney with Atkinson, Anderson, Boyle, Wu, and Romo to do our presentation this evening. So I know she has a PowerPoint, which the materials are in front of you. And for those guests in the audience, there are some that are on the table in the hall. If you'd like to have those copies, we're going to transition here. And so thank you very much, Barbara, for joining us.
It is my pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for the invitation. It's great to see all the stakeholders here in the district wanting to get a little bit more informed about the Brown Act, and it's a subject that a lot of people are a little nervous about or scared about or afraid that they don't know enough about, and so it definitely is worthwhile to every once in a while have these types of informational meetings where we can get everybody on the same page. You'll notice in the packet that's before you, I've included two things. One is the PowerPoint presentation on the right side, and you can follow along with the slides and take any notes that you feel might be relevant. On the left side is a more comprehensive outline of the Brown Act. So if you're looking for some reading material at night, or if you have some further questions, or you're looking for something that might not go into as much, or we'll go into some more depth than we might go into today, if you're looking for some case law support and things like that, that Brown Act outline helps to clarify some of those items. And you'll notice on most all of the slides that I'll be presenting to you today, at the very bottom, there's a reference to the page number in the outline that corresponds with what we're talking about. So my goal is to try and make it easy for you to go back and be able to reference things if you wanted to. So just a little bit about myself. I work with Atkinson, Anderson, Lawyer, Root, and Romo. I've been with the firm since 2008. It's about my 20th or 21st year as an attorney now. Do a lot of labor negotiations and just represent school districts and community college districts. It's one of my favorite things is to be out at our districts, being able to give presentations and help you with your knowledge enhancement. So today we're going to be briefly going, well, for the next hour or so, going through the Brown Act, and there's several subjects that we'll cover. We're going to cover the intent of the Brown Act so everybody understands why the legislature gave us this creation in the first place. Then we'll talk a little bit about what constitutes a legislative body and a member of a board. Then we're going to go into what is a meeting, and we'll spend some good time there discussing serial meetings and ways to avoid violations of the Brown Act when it comes to meetings. We'll talk about the public meeting procedures, a little bit about agendas, about public participation, all which are elements of the Brown Act. Then we'll talk specifically about closed session, which is an exception that allows us to hold meetings outside the view of the public. And then we'll talk briefly about how the Brown Act is enforced. So first here we have the intent and the rule of the Brown Act. The intent of the act is really this. It's a law that public agencies, any public agency, actions have to be taken openly and their deliberations need to be conducted openly. The people of the state in creating boards of local agencies don't yield their sovereignty to the agencies that serve them. So in other words, nobody's above the public. The public has the ultimate view, viewpoint and participation in each of our public agencies. And so that's why the law was created to make sure that whenever we're doing deliberations, whenever we are making decisions or collectively reaching a concurrence about what we would like to do, those types of deliberations are supposed to take place in the open so that the public can see them and the public can have the opportunity to comment before a final decision is made. That being said, while meetings are open to the public, they are not public meetings. In other words, they're not meetings where the public is invited to participate in all aspects of the meeting. There are time and place restrictions as to what can be said, but the purpose of the Brown Act is really to say that we want our business conducted in the open so that it's transparent, so that the public has an idea of what the business of the district is or the business of the public agency and the decisions that are being made. There's no secrets. So in light of this constitutional enactment and the legislative policies that interpret the Brown Act, it's really a law that's liberally interpreted in the courts that are in favor of public participation. So again, the purpose of the act is to be transparent and to make sure that the public is informed of the business of the district. All meetings of a legislative body of the public agency have to be open and public. And everybody that attends is permitted to attend any meeting of the legislative body unless there's an exception in the Brown Act. And, you know, most notably are closed sessions. We know that the public is not invited to attend closed sessions of the board. So anytime there's an exception is the only time that we can come outside of the Brown Act and not hold our meetings in public. So the first thing that we have to look at and to see if we're even subject to the Brown Act is whether an entity fits within the definition of a legislative body so that it would be subject to the Brown Act. So what is a legislative body? Really, there's several types of bodies that we're talking about that are subject to the Brown Act. The first is a governing body. And a governing body is any kind of body that was created by statutes. Our legislature enacted laws to make sure that there's certain types of bodies that are going to be known as legislative or governing bodies. So these are things like governing boards of school districts or community college districts, city councils, county board of supervisors. These are all legislatively created, and therefore they are subject to the Brown Act. Then we have the subsidiary bodies of these legislative bodies. So all of our governing boards, we have things like committees or commissions, personnel commission. These are all bodies that are created by the governing board or whatever the legislative body, and I'm going to just continue to refer to the district today and the school board because that's who I'm speaking to, but it really applies to any legislative body. If a legislative body like a school board creates by resolution or by formal action some sort of commission or committee, then those are considered to be subsidiary bodies of the general board. And then of course we also have some other entities. If we have any kind of entity that's created by an elected legislative body that has is assigning authority to delegate some of its authority to that kind of board, then that would also be a legislative body that's subject to the Brown Act. Okay, basically with subsidiary bodies, that middle category that I was talking about, there's really two main types of subsidiary bodies. And the first one is called a standing committee. standing committee, irrespective of their composition, they are the type of body that has continuing subject matter jurisdiction. They usually meet on a fixed schedule, and they are legislative bodies for the purpose of applying the Brown Act. The Brown Act always applies to standing committees. Ad hoc committees are generally temporary committees, and they may be subject to the Brown Act. Most ad hoc committees they're only exempt from the Brown Act if the ad hoc committee is comprised solely of members of the board, and they're only advisory, so they're not a decision-making body, if they're only advisory, and if the number of people that sit on that ad hoc committee from the board is less than a quorum of the board. In that case, it's not considered to be the type of committee that needs to be governed by the Brown Act, so we call it exempt from the Brown Act. But if an ad hoc committee has any of its members that are not members of the board, of the school board, then that ad hoc committee is subject to the Brown Act. So in order to be exempt, it has to be only members of the board that are sitting on that ad hoc committee. So the other kinds of committees, though, that we frequently see in school districts are committees that are created by the superintendent. So the superintendent might create a committee, but it hasn't been a committee that's formally adopted or formally created by a board. Those committees are also not subject to the Brown Act. The only exception to that would be is if you have a board that, I don't know, incited or instigated the formation of that committee. So if the board did it with strong suggestion that a committee be formed, even though it didn't take formal action, then that board, that committee might be subject to the Brown Act. So here's just a little chart to help you with a if yes or no. If you have a standing committee, if the answer is yes, then it's not exempt from the Brown Act. If it's not a standing committee, then we go on to the next question, and we look at whether it's an ad hoc committee. So if you have an ad hoc committee, you ask yourself, is it advisory only? If no, then it's not exempt. You have to apply the rules of the Brown Act. If the answer is yes, we move on to the next question, and we look at the composition of the committee. If it includes a majority of the board, then it's not exempt. It's subject to the Brown Act. But if it doesn't constitute a majority of the board, and it's composed solely of less than a majority of the governing board, and it doesn't have any non-board members, then yes, then it's exempt. And if no, then it's subject to the Brown Act. Okay, some of the things that are not legislative bodies and therefore not are subject to the Act, I included these just so you can have an idea of some of the other types of committees or bodies that are not legislative bodies. In order to be subject to the Brown Act, you have to be a decision-making body, a legislative body, and so we have other types of committees that aren't. If it's advisory only, if committees formed by the superintendent, committees created through the collective bargaining process, so sometimes we have like a health and welfare benefits committee that was created through the collective bargaining process, both parties agree that we're going to have this committee, it's not necessarily subject to the Brown Act requirements as well. There's a list of additional types of committees that are not necessarily subject to all the requirements of the Brown Act. The rules with regarding to some of these committees are that they have to hold meetings that are open to the public, and they have to provide the public the opportunity to address items that are on their agendas, and their agendas do have to be posted at least 72 hours in advance. And if a committee that has to have these posting constitution now, and if they're meeting for the purpose of hearing, discussing, deliberating, or taking action on any item that's within the subject matter of the board, then that's considered to be a meeting. Whether or not you take action is irrelevant. This is where people really get off track with the Brown Act. They think that, oh, well, we might have met together collectively, but we didn't take any action, and so there's no harm, there's no foul. But the Brown Act is much broader than that. The Brown Act says it could be a meeting, and therefore subject to the Brown Act, if you are even hearing information, discussing things, trying to gain a collective acquisition of information in order to make a determination, that's all considered stuff that could be a meeting within the meaning of the Brown Act, and therefore subject to the requirements of the Brown Act. So Meetings include things like this, the study session today. It could be listed as an informational meeting, a fact-finding meeting, or pre-meetings. Whatever, however informal or however formal it is, if it contains a majority of the board members and you're taking any of these actions, then it's going to be considered a meeting that is subject to the Brown Act. So let's talk about what's a serial meeting. Okay, when a majority of the members of the legislative body meet outside of a notice public meeting, and they use a series of communications of any kind, whether they communicate directly with each other, or they use an intermediary, like they go through the superintendent or something. Whenever they meet outside of an organized public meeting and they discuss or deliberate or take action on things that are within the subject matter jurisdiction of the board, that's what we call a serial meeting. That's a meeting that can't take place. And what the law is really concerned about is board members collectively gathering information to reach a decision before it's had the opportunity to deliberate that decision in front of the public. We don't want you to pre-make up your mind over things. We don't want you to deliberate with other people. We don't want you to share your opinions with other board members. We don't want you to find out what the other board members are thinking and somehow be swayed to think a particular way on an issue, because what the Brown Act says is those types of deliberations are the very ones that are supposed to take place in view of the public, so the public can understand your reasoning, so your constituents who elected you to your positions or appointed you to your positions understand what your position is on this and how you're participating in arriving at a decision that actually represents them. So it's very important that you check yourselves. That's the only way I can say it, is you have to be your own check as to whether or not you're having discussions about business of the district outside of the public setting. So just to give some examples, informal sessions at which the board commits itself collectively to a future decision is prohibited. So if you have somebody that's calling you and saying, I really want to get your commitment on this, can I count on you to make sure that this is the way that you're going to vote at the next meeting, those types of meetings are prohibited by the Brown Act. Now, if you have, for instance, a superintendent individually speaking with each board member to answer questions or provide information, that's okay. And the way we look at that is you're pushing out information. Anytime information is being pushed out to you, that's okay. That's for your information gathering for you to consider as an individual. Where it starts to look like it might fall into the lines of a serial meeting is when there's some sort of discussions that are going back and forth regarding the information. That's not to say you can't have a discussion with the superintendent and get your questions answered and have that type of discussion. Where it crosses the line, and what the Brown Act is concerned about, is where you are trying to collectively gather information in advance and developing a concurrence of opinion in advance of a meeting, and that's what's prohibited. So other examples that I have here, if you're just a distribution to each of you of a legal memo that was written by the attorney for the district, or when staff provides background information, you usually get a board packet on a Friday that provides information, that push out of information is not in itself a meeting. It's okay for you to review that information in your solitary confines of your home or your office or wherever you're looking at that information. But if you call the next board member or you call somebody else and start deliberating about the information that you've received, that's when it becomes a problematic violation of the Brown Act. These types of meetings, it's not just when you call somebody or see somebody in person, it's if you leave phone messages, we have texting, we have email. All these things pose a danger for us because it has the danger of being passed on to another person who's then gonna understand what your position is and might influence their position. So the goal is not to form any type of collective concurrence in advance of a meeting that's held and open to the public. Another example is a mediator. So there's a famous case where a board was trying to reach a settlement on an issue, and they invited into closed session the person that they were trying to settle with and that person's legal counsel. So that was a violation of the Brown Act right then. There's no exception in the Brown Act which allows you to invite opposing counsel in and deliberate and have settlement negotiations there. But they also invited a mediator. Now the mediator did not come into the board meeting but stayed outside. So what happened is board members, one or two at a time, would go outside and talk to the mediator and then go back into the board meeting and talk with the person they were trying to settle with. So the mediator was able to reach a settlement on behalf of the parties, but it was determined to violate the Brown Act because the way that the collective concurrence was obtained to have a settlement was not directly between board members. They weren't talking to each other about it, but they all went to that mediator who collected all their information and got their collective concurrence together. So that violates the Brown Act. It's different than just having a closed session meeting where you can talk about what you'd like to have as terms of a settlement agreement or give your authority to a negotiator or an attorney to go and negotiate a settlement. That would be different. That would fall within the closed session meeting exceptions for the Brown Act, and you'd be able to do that. The proper way that they should have handled this was to delegate that authority to their attorney or somebody, and then have the attorney go out and meet with a mediator and try and reach a settlement, and then come back to the board for approval. So the way that they handled it was just not correct. Okay, let's talk about a couple things that are not serial meetings. So if we have an employer or an official of the district that engages in separate conversations or communications that are outside of our public and open meeting, and they're answering questions, like I said, the push out of information, so long as the person that's pushing out the information doesn't go and then share the information with other board members. So for instance, if the superintendent wanted to provide each of you with a series of information or memos or background information, and you want to call her and have questions answered, that's fine. The superintendent, though, is prohibited from sharing what you've talked about with her with the next board member, though. That would be a violation of the act. And it goes both ways. So if you know that your colleagues are talking with the superintendent, you can't go and then ask another colleague, you know, information about what they heard from the superintendent as well. You need to each deal with the superintendent individually. The second one, the bullet point on here is sort of the catch-all that's in the Brown Act, and you gotta love these kinds of phrases. Individual contacts or conversations between a board member and any other person are okay as long as you're not violating the Brown Act. So it just basically says, you know, you can talk with other people, but just make sure you're not violating the Brown Act. And really, the bottom line with this is it's not as scary as a lot of people make it out to be. You just have to check yourself and not be talking about district business outside of the open meeting. That's all. Attendance of a majority of board members, you guys can go as a majority to a conference or some other open and public conference. It has to be open and public. It can't be like a private Elks Club meeting or something that nobody else is invited to. It has to be an open or conference, and you can go as a majority and discuss issues of general concern to your school district or to school districts in general, provided that when you're at that conference, you can't go and discuss these issues with each other. So you can discuss them at the conference out in the open, but you can't go and then have meetings about things that are specific to your district with each other. Those types of things have to take place in an open and public meeting. Another example, attendance of a majority of the board members at an open and publicized meeting that's organized to address a topic of local community concern by a person or organization that is not the district. So if you're talking about maybe another meeting or community-based meeting within your community, you can go as a majority of board members, but again, the prohibition is discussing amongst yourselves things that transpire at that meeting. You can talk in an open and public meeting about issues, but what I would caution you, and I'm very cautious about the Brown Act, there's always going to be that perception that you're divulging your opinion and your your final decision on something out in public. So I would suggest that if you're going to go to other meetings of general local concern, that you not do too much to divulge that you've made a final decision. If you want to discuss an issue and you want to have, you have some information about that as a member of the public, you want to talk about things, and you're there and other board members are there, that's fine to discuss in public, but just be aware that there's going to be a public perception that if you're talking at that meeting and then you're going to come back to your board meeting later, that maybe you already made up your mind at that other meeting. So just be careful about how you, what you say.
That's a very fine line on that.
Very fine.
When you say something in public, your other board members who are also there know how to lean on it.
Exactly.
So that can be in public.
And that's
been told just not.
Exactly, that's the danger of it. And that's why, my personal recommendation is, you know, you just don't discuss your district's business in other forums. But the Brown Act doesn't prohibit it. What the Brown Act prohibits is if you discuss it amongst yourselves. So the key factor here is that because you're at an open and public meeting and everybody can hear it, it's not a secret deliberation. You're not secretly now, just because you're there with a majority of your board members, you're not secretly devising something outside of the, you know, open and public meeting. You're at a open and public meeting, and that's why it's not prohibited by the Brown Act. But if you were to then go and deliberate amongst yourself, leave that meeting and go outside and talk about everybody's position at that meeting or something, then now you're really riding that fine line about, well, you know, that behavior is absolutely prohibited in the first place, but that's when you ride that fine line of perception at the meeting, even if you didn't engage in anything improper when you were there.
Can I ask a question? What if it's not a majority, and what if, you know, say I want to contact some of the people and ask them about the meeting schedule that, you know, I have in my mind that I'd like to have another meeting prior to the scheduled one? Is that outside of the violation? Because
well, the concern,
I'm contacting people.
The concern about the Brown Act is arriving at decisions that impact the business of the district. So I think information, if you're calling to say, hey, is there a board meeting on Tuesday, then, you know, that would be something that I can't see that that would be a violation of the Brown Act that would have any kind of prejudice on district business. The concern of the Brown Act is when you are deliberating about business that you have to arrive at a decision at or take action at a board meeting.
We're bond oversight committee, we're not.
Right. Well, now the other concern though would be is if you called them up and then started exchanging information about the meeting. You know, if you're going into the substance of what's going to be talked at the meeting, no, you can't do that. But I think if you're talking
If it's a subject that hasn't been discussed before, not on any agenda?
I think it's within the subject matter of the jurisdiction of your committee, and so I would stay away from discussing that kind of business.
If I can add to that, just from a piece, when you'll observe and when at the CPOC meeting, you adopt your meeting calendar in public at your meeting. Mm-hmm. And so it would not be necessarily the role for you to call and figure that out. That is something we do in public, so that everybody has an opportunity to determine what that schedule is.
Unfortunately, the members don't discuss it. It's more or less handed to them. So that's another subject.
Yeah. How would that fall in line in creating agendas?
I'm not sure I understand your question.
If we're going to create an agenda for the next meeting and the other meeting, the communication that we would have, what we would like to place on the agenda. How would that
fall? So do you usually have a central person that creates the agenda then? Or, I mean, you have, anybody can request information to be put on an agenda. It's the discussion of the substance of the materials that you would be able to discuss. So.
And are you allowed to speak to one board member about certain things? That's what I was told.
You can't, you run a danger if you are, well, the danger here is a majority. See, all these have the word
so
majority highlighted.
One is okay, but not two.
So, yeah, but when you're, you don't want to discuss district business with another board member. That's not, you know, you don't want to discuss this substantive business with other board members.
Question. What happens, say, like, we were down to San Diego, the entire board, and the three of us were walking around where they had all the displays, and the architect was there that's doing the project, there's people there selling books and other programs, and we get in a conversation with them. And later on, they are presenting their items that they're trying to sell, to sell it to our district. And we've had this discussion, three of us sitting there talking to them at the conference.
You know, that's an interesting question, because the conference is an open conference. It's open to the public. Public can attend. And part of the purpose of the conference is meeting with, you know, meeting vendors and having the opportunity to meet with vendors. I think the difficulty that comes into play is if you start having discussions with other board members about, oh, this is the person that we should be doing business with, because that's the type of information that should be back at your open board meeting. Other things that aren't a serial meeting, attendance of a majority of the board members at a purely social or ceremonial occasion, that's okay. Attendance of a majority of board members at an open and noticed meeting of a standing committee of the board. So, board members, you can attend a meeting of the personnel commission, which is a standing committee. If you have a board member who's not a member of that, of the personnel commission, then they can only attend as observers. You can't attend as a participant. So just a quick summary of some of the comparisons under the Brown Act. Again, subject to the Brown Act would be things like a superintendent individually polling the school board on a personnel issue and then emailing all the board members about the results. Okay, that's a collective sharing, an attempt to collectively gather information to form an opinion or arrive at a collective concurrence before a public meeting occurs. Another example of things that would be subject to the Brown Act, board members' spouses meet and they discuss school business, and then they later report back to their husbands and wives what was discussed. Okay, you can't use your spouse as an intermediary to gather information about what fellow board members are thinking. That would be something that's subject to the Brown Act. And a majority of board members emailing each other to confer prior to a special meeting. So again, you don't, majority of the board members, you can't email each other, you can't form a collective concurrence before a meeting. So things that would be exempt from the Brown Act, and these are okay to do, a majority of the school boards emailing each other about the governor's race. Okay, that doesn't necessarily, and that's not within your jurisdiction, and so that would be okay to email with each other about. Majority of the school board going out to breakfast once a month but not discussing school business. That's okay. Want to stop and have an ice cream after the meeting or something, that's okay, as long as you're not discussing business. Of course, there's the perception. So that's where you have this trust that you need to be able to build with your constituency, because people are going to see you out, they're going to know that you're board members, and the natural inclination is to say, oh, they're board members, they're all together, they must be discussing school business or district business. And, you know, that's where you have to be able to swear under oath that you weren't engaging in those types of conversations. But sometimes the public perception is a more difficult animal to deal with, and so you have to consider those things before you make a decision to go out and have those.
Out and you miss someone, we're going to ask you what's opinion about a special issue, so that means you cannot see anything, right?
To a fellow, you can't have a deliberation with a fellow board member about that, about the business. That's what they are.
No, I just want to know what should we do, so we cannot see anything. They ask you what's your opinion about some issue.
You're talking about a fellow board member, or you're talking just about a member of the public?
Who's asking? Is it community members asking you, or are board members asking you?
No, I mean the public.
Oh no, you can have discussions with your
The public asks. If they ask us or ask a board member, you know, some special issue, asking what's your opinion.
You can have an opinion about a subject.
Can you see anything?
You can have an opinion about a subject. You can't collectively meet with your the majority of your fellow members to discuss that. That's the
you and I can't talk about.
Right.
Okay, we can tell public, but we can like share each other.
Yes.
Okay.
So here's some charts to try to give a little bit of an example, okay? So this would be a prohibited serial meeting. This envisions seven board members by all the little circles. So board member number one has a discussion with board member number two, who then has a discussion with board member number three. Okay, the presumption there is that you're all sharing information, and that is not proper, because it's not taking place out in the open in front of the public for, you know, for them to see the type of conversation that you're having about whatever information that you're sharing. Second diagram here is the one that we talked about. So you have a district staff member in the center, usually the superintendent, pushing information out to each individual board member. Okay, and you notice that none of the arrows are connecting any of the board members. That means everybody's getting their information, they're reviewing it on their own, nobody's talking about it with each other, and it's presumed that the superintendent, in pushing out information, is not sharing information about any other board members' opinions. In fact, in this diagram, no arrows are going in to the superintendent, so the board members are not sharing information with the superintendent that could then go on to another board member. So that's a proper, permitted distribution of information, and that's not a violation of the Brown Act.
Can the staff do two people and then two people?
Yes, because it's not a majority. Yes.
Even though it's the same information.
Yes, it's a push out of information, and it's not a majority. But the concern mostly is the push out of information. That's okay. It's not a two-way conversation that might raise some red flags, and it's definitely not a conversation between board members. This is the trickier slide, and we have lots of arguments in my own firm about this one. Because this is one, for instance, where the staff is pushing out information, but then there's some board members, and in this case, a majority of the board members are contacting that staff member, presumably the superintendent, and having a discussion about the matter. So it's the word discussion that is a little bit tricky, because let's say those arrows are okay if it's just a question and answer kind of session. You know, if you received information from the superintendent, you have some questions or need some clarification, you ask the superintendent provides the answers to you, that's fine. Where this slide gets into danger is if there's a discussion where maybe we're trying to get a collective concurrence before a board, you know, before the open and public session. That's where it can be a problem. So that's why I put down in the corner, if this is consensus building, even if the superintendent doesn't share it with all the other board members, but if there's a perception that there's some sort of consensus building going on, that could be problematic. I'm not saying that this slide is a violation of the Brown Act. I'm saying this is the kind of slide that raises the red flag that you should be concerned about, is having these discussions. It really should be limited to information push out and asking questions about that information. And then you, as the individual board or commission members, forming your own opinions, which you then bring to an open and public meeting and disclose those in public, so everybody in the public has a chance to hear what you have to say about it, and then everybody can collectively deliberate.
So let me get straight there. If the superintendent sends out her weekly summary, and there's something in there that I have a question about, if I have a question, I can just go and ask the question.
Yes.
But I cannot ask the question and say, it'd be nice to have a district-wide committee look at this.
Well, again, that's not necessarily revealing some sort of collective, it depends on what the issue is, you know, about what you're revealing in the information. So if you're trying to arrive at some sort of collective concurrence, that's where this becomes a problem. So I think you can ask your questions, you can certainly state your opinion, and then it would be up to the superintendent to make sure she's not sharing that with other board members. But, you know, if the superintendent then was in turn strong-arming you to do a particular thing, or you were attempting to strong-arm the superintendent and say, well, I really want this to be done, and, you know, maybe you can find out what the other board members have to say about that, or maybe you can suggest to other board members that this go out, then that would become problematic.
So you can give an opinion.
Yes.
And what would be the best thing? Bring it up at the agenda so all of us could talk about it.
Right.
You have this great idea.
Exactly.
So all of us can learn from it.
Exactly. That's what we mean by public participation and transparency, is now we're getting to see these decisions made out in the public forum. We're getting to see, you know, why that was a good suggestion and whatever, how everybody else felt about it. And there's not that perception that this was already taken care of in secret, that we were going to form this committee and it was already a done deal. The public has the opportunity to see.
Because it wasn't on the agenda, though, you can't just bring it up. You might want to make it in the comment section.
Yes.
And then product for a future meeting, suggest to staff if we look into something?
Exactly. So again, here's the good kind of meeting, permitted questions and answers. We don't see any arrows connecting any board members. The key here, again, is whoever the staff member is in the center that's receiving all the questions and answers, they are bound not to communicate the comments or the positions of the individual board members that they're hearing from. So they're sort of sworn by that secrecy that they're going to know everything, they're going to know what all the board members think, but we can't share that outside the context of the building board.
What if it was the opposite way? That we get the information and then we ask the questions?
That's fine too. That's fine, because as long as you're not discussing it with your fellow board members.
Just the other, like,
so something comes out from the community and you have a question for the superintendent and you want to ask that, the push, you know, the asking the question and the push out of information, the superintendent would likely be obligated to share information that was of a general concern to the board with other members without sharing what your personal viewpoint or opinion.
And if it was just two of them, that would be okay too, the question and answer both ways?
Between the staff
two
and the board member?
Or one staff.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, so the danger though is then if they are together when it's happening and then there's, I mean, if it's just a question and answer, that's one thing, but if there's going to be any kind of, the danger is if somebody shares an opinion, you know, if somebody then, you know, if three and four go in together and talk to the superintendent and it's just question and answer, but then number three reveals, well, I feel this way, but well, now number four knows and that's prohibited. So that's the danger, and that's why individual contact is better. It's always better until you are in an open and public meeting setting where everybody can be together. Okay, this is just a confusing one, but it's to point out email, okay? And the problem with this is email is okay. When you receive information by email, that's okay. That's just a passive act. You're clicking on open in your email box and you're receiving information and you're reading it. That's all right. But the problem becomes when you hit reply all. So you have to be careful in your email to make sure it's not set to allow you to hit reply all. Even if, you know, numbers 2 through 7 are just reading their email, the fact that number one is providing information about how they feel about something to the staff person in the middle. So in this email, what happened is the superintendent sent out an email to all the board members. Everybody read their email, but number one decided to communicate with the superintendent about it and shared some personal thoughts or feelings about the issue. But when they did, they hit reply all and it went to all the board members. So even though the board members weren't expecting to have any kind of serial meeting, now they're suddenly drawn into it's a serial meeting because they've received information that shares that opinion.
And what do you do if that should happen? Let's say somebody did it by, even unintentionally, hit reply all, and then everybody got their opinion.
That's when hopefully, there's nothing that you can do to backtrack that, but just be aware that it raises a level of a potential Brown Act violation. So if somebody wanted to complain, somebody found out about that and then an action was taken, I mean, it just depends on what the perceived harm is to the public of, you know, did that, having that email influence the decision, and so there may be remedies that have to be addressed that way. But just, yeah, you can't undo the send on the email.
You can retract an email if they have an open data.
Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't.
But sometimes, you know, the other thing is that if you forward an email or even if you respond, it shows all the other previous emails that were sent. Up to the time you respond. So
right.
You might respond to one, but the other previous 5 emails followed behind.
It's like email
now
is such a danger.
About 5 other people upset.
Email is such a danger in so many respects. You know, just as a communication tool, I know it's convenient, but it's also such a poor communication tool because you can't gauge somebody's disposition in an email. You don't have that opportunity to meet face to face with somebody. So just as a tool, it can be a destructive communication tool, and then in a setting where you have to be particularly careful, like when you're a member of a legislative body or a subsidiary of a legislative body, you just have to be really careful with these kinds of communications. And try not, there's a way in your email where you can eliminate all the other, you can only, you know, do the one that you're responding to and eliminate the trail of all of them, but it takes It takes some forethought.
I'd teach you to start a new thread.
Right.
And start holding a meeting.
Okay. Yes.
We have more than email now. How about Facebook, Instagram, and those things? Can we post our comments on Facebook and what happened with other vendors responding or how? That'd be really very difficult for us to control this.
Right. You really run the risk when you're putting your opinions out on a particular issue that's within the subject matter of the board, and you're putting those opinions out onto Facebook. It runs the risk of a serial meeting because, you know, intentionally. It's an act that you've intentionally done, and it could influence other people's decisions or cause that collective, exchange of facts or something in trying to arrive at a concurrence. So all I can say is you have to be very aware of what you're doing and the people that it can get out to. And when the danger is if it gets out to the majority of your board members, that could be a violation of the Brown Act.
So social media is not considered a public forum?
Social media is not considered a public forum. Well, it's not a public forum. It's the fact that there is the potential for arriving at a collective opinion in advance of a public meeting. It is a public forum, but in order to comply with the Brown Act, your meeting has to be an open and noticed meeting in order, you know, where you're exchanging information in public. So exchanging information on Facebook, even though it's open to the public, it doesn't fall with, you know, your Facebook account isn't falling within the public meeting requirements of the Brown Act, where you have to have notice of a meeting and post it and have an agenda.
But you said the board member and us, we can express our opinion.
Yes, you can express your opinion.
Same like on Facebook.
No, because expressing your opinion in an email to the superintendent or having a conversation directly with the superintendent is not the same as posting your opinion on Facebook.
But if we were approached by somebody in the public asking our opinion, wouldn't we be obligated as citizen oversight to give it?
Yes. So long as you're not sharing it and deliberating amongst yourselves about your opinions. You can all have your opinions. The danger that you run into is when you start sharing your opinions with each other and you have discussions about business that should take place in front of a public body, when you start having those opinions with each other.
And I thought we don't give our opinion because we speak as five people and only the president can speak for us.
Right. I mean, that when you're making a collective decision, that's correct. When you speak and they take action, it's as a group. But it doesn't mean you're not an individual with your own opinion. So
can you make it clear that you're not speaking to the board?
Yes, but the danger again is who you're talking to and whether that is going to lead to, you know, you're talking to your spouse about your opinion and your spouse is a friend with his spouse, you know, and they talk to each other. It's those types of, you have to, it's determining where the information is going. That's what the issue is. Okay, let's talk about public meeting procedures and public participation. So public meeting procedures, certain boards, and this, I didn't modify it in here, but I modified it in all your handbooks. Certain boards, including community college district boards, and that should not say unified school district boards, it should say county boards, must meet at least monthly and must by rule fix the time and place for their regular meetings. So the general rule is this: as a unified school district, you don't have to have monthly meetings, but you do have to fix your meetings by rules. It has to be set in your board policy as to the time and place of your regular scheduled board meetings. Community college districts and county boards of education, they're a little bit different. They're required to have monthly board meetings. They can't skip out on any meetings. And then high school districts are also a little bit different. If you're a joint union high school district or union high school district, you only have to have meetings quarterly. So you get the choice of monthly or quarterly. But with you guys, it just has to be fixed by your board policy. It doesn't have to be monthly, and that's for your regular meetings. So regular meetings and special meetings have to be held within the territory of the district, and there's some limited exceptions. And I don't know if you wanted me, if that was an issue that you wanted me to
be able to address with you as to what the exceptions were, but there's a list of things, like if you're out inspecting real property that has to do with the business of the district and that real property doesn't fall within the jurisdiction, you are able to do something like that. And there's a couple of other small exceptions about when you can have something outside the jurisdiction of the district. All your open and public meetings have to comply with the Americans with Disabilities Act. So you want to make sure that whenever somebody is making a request to be accommodated, that those that your meetings are accommodated as well. Let's talk about meeting materials. So anything that somebody's going to need for the meeting, whether it's the agenda packet, anybody, member of the public can request a mailed agenda or an agenda packet. And it's the district gets to charge for the cost of providing that service. So what we mean by cost of providing the service doesn't necessarily just encompass the copy of the document. It can be the copy plus the mailing fee plus a reasonable employee time having to provide copies of those documents. When do we have to provide this? Well, the district has to mail out the agenda and the packet to people who have requested it at the time that the agenda is posted or whenever the district sends it out to all or a majority of the board members, whichever happens first. That's when you have to send it out to people on your list. People will make requests, a standing request, to have all their agendas and agenda packets mailed to them. And those requests are valid for one calendar year. So everybody has to renew their requests on January 1st.
Can we require that they pay the fee in advance?
I don't recommend that only because, I mean, you can set up a rule as to what works for the district. It is a convenience to be able to say, this is already taken care of and paid for, but what if they relinquish their request and they decide halfway through they don't want that service anymore, then they've already paid for those things for the entire year, and so that could become problematic. So, but you are able to set whatever rule you want and encompass the cost of providing the service.
I thought there was a recent legislation that changed that.
You know, I'm not aware. So, it is something I've missed and I'm not up to date on. But you can require. Do you recall what the legislation said? I'll look into it. if you have someone with a disability that's requesting that the agenda or the agenda packet be made available to them in an alternate format, you have to provide that to somebody that's making that request. And when you mail the packet, there's no further responsibility to ensure that the packet actually makes it to the person that was requesting it. Once we put it in the mail and we've complied with their request, if a person doesn't receive it, if it gets lost in the mail, that does not provide grounds for somebody to come back and say, well, I didn't receive that, so that should invalidate any action that the board took at the meeting because I didn't get my packet and I didn't know whether to come to the meeting and participate. Let's talk specifically about the agenda. The agenda has to contain certain things. First of all, it has to specify the time and the location of the meeting. It has to be conspicuously posted. I can't remember the specific entity that case concerned. Let's see. It is a requirement under law that agendas be posted online. That was incorporated into the Brown Act now. So we do have to post all of our agendas online. And it has to be in a place that's easily noticed. People shouldn't have to dig on your website in order to be able to find the agenda. It should be someplace that they can find. If you don't properly notice something on the agenda, then you can't take any action on it. The agenda also has to include information regarding how and to whom and when to make a request for disability-related modification or accommodation that you might need in attending a board meeting. So if you have specific disability-related needs, people just need to know, who do I go to request that? And you can also, you could put in your agenda what types of auxiliary aids might be available so that they're aware of what kinds of services that you can provide as well. You have to give the public sufficient detail of matters to be considered to allow the public to decide whether or not to participate at the meeting, including a brief general description, and if you don't, the action that's taken on the matter by the board could be void. So this is an area that we run into a lot of trouble with. I deal with a lot of boards that have been you know, one school district boards that are in the middle of farmland, and maybe they are a little more lax with the way that they write their agendas. But really, when you think about it, if you remember the public and you saw an agenda posted and it had a line item on there about an item of business that was going to be discussed at the board, you want to know what that means. You just, and the description doesn't have to be long. When we say a general brief description, it doesn't have to be more than 20 words, but it just has to give the public an idea of, ooh, do I want to show up at that meeting and make a public comment about it? Is that something that, you know, do I understand from that agenda item what the board is going to be doing at this meeting? So we run into this sometimes, for instance, in negotiations, when the boards have sunshine proposals that they receive. As an example, an inadequate sunshine proposal would be the union sunshining, I want to see Article 10 salary, and then that's their sunshine proposal. Okay, that doesn't give sufficient information to the public to say, do I want to show up and make a public comment about salary? You know, it would have been more complete had the sunshine proposal included something that said, we are seeking a salary increase of 14%. That might be something that somebody wants to come in and talk about. It's the same with your agendas. You want to make sure your agenda is sufficiently descriptive so that a member of the public can say, I want to come in and exercise my right to publicly participate in the meeting by making a public comment or hearing the deliberations on this matter. They just have to know from your agenda item a sufficient amount of information to help them make that decision.
But if they aren't giving you that sufficient information, for example, purchasing equipment for $62,000 and purchasing so-and-so equipment, bingo, without explaining why or even an amount, people don't, you know, so can somebody fight that?
Somebody, it depends on how much, like for instance, how much money is being spent. If you were to put something on an agenda that said consideration of new IT equipment, well, do you mean IT equipment for the district office? Do you mean it for the entire school district? Do you mean it for a school site? Having a little bit more information in there to help narrow it down for the public so they understand the scope of what the board is doing at that meeting. So that's what, it's not a perfect, you know, it doesn't have to be a perfect wording. It doesn't have to incorporate all the terms that somebody is wanting, you know, that's going to cost $165,000. It doesn't necessarily have to include that. It just has to provide sufficient information. And if it doesn't provide sufficient information, then sure, an interested an interested person might say, I didn't have sufficient information. It wasn't a very descriptive agenda, and I missed out on my opportunity. But it's, the arguments could be made both ways. You know, if you've substantially complied and given at least a hint of information, what we're going to see in another section of the slides is what we call safe harbor provisions. When we have closed session agenda items, you know, closed session is really a more, I don't want to say secretive process because we're still doing the business of the district, but it is a more sensitive process in which we don't open it up to the public for a variety of reasons. It might be something that would, you know, if we opened it up to the public, it would jeopardize the litigation that we're in, or it might jeopardize our ability to settle a matter, or it might be a personnel matter. So there's a lot of reasons that we don't put some things into the public session. There's only a very limited amount of exceptions. But what we'll see in future slides here is that the legislature has created what we call safe harbor provisions, where it provides these very brief descriptions that are intended to give the public enough information for, you know, just to alleviate these concerns that you've been talking about. So for instance, we'll see a provision in there that talks about labor negotiations. What we're obligated to do is put on our agenda that we're going to discuss labor negotiations in closed session. And then because of the wording in the safe harbor provisions, we're required to name the person that's going to be negotiating on behalf of the district, the name of the union that we're going to be negotiating with. And then the legislature says that that's sufficient information for us to put on our agenda to comply with the Brown Act. So we have those types of guidance for closed session agenda items, but the potential number of items that could be on an open and public session, there's no way for the legislature to give us enough examples of language that would satisfy the Brown Act to put there. So they haven't created those legislative examples like they have for closed session items. That's why we just have to use our discretion and good sense to be able to put sufficient information to allow the public to decide whether or not they want to participate. Okay, more on meeting materials. All your meeting materials, your agendas, any other writings that are associated with your public session, anything that's distributed to all or majority of the members of the board, in connection with anything that's within the subject matter that's being considered by the board, it all becomes public record. That's the bottom line. Anything that's handed out there, it all becomes public record, and so somebody can make that request, a Public Records Act request, to see certain information that was distributed at a board meeting, and that information has to be made available without delay. There are exceptions to the Public Records Act, and they're extremely numerous, and they're listed in statute. But there's things like a personnel exception. Your personnel files are not a public record that can be necessarily disclosed. Your closed session records, like your resolutions that you pass in closed session, your closed session minutes, are generally exempt from disclosure under the Public Records Act as well. Related writings for material. So if you have writings that are related to an open session agenda item, and let's say they're distributed less than 72 hours. For instance, like my presentation materials today, they weren't 72 hours in advance. So these writings have to be made available for public inspection at the, you know, at the district office or wherever location you designate on your agenda. And at the it has to be made available at the time that it's distributed to all or majority of the board members. If you have documents that are prepared by the district in anticipation for a board meeting, then those have to be made available at the meeting also. So the board, the district prepares an agenda or other information packet items, that stuff has to be here, ready to be handed out at the meeting. Documents that are prepared by other people, like for instance my documents here, they could be made available after the meeting. People can come in and inspect it. The district can also charge a fee for copying public records, but they can't impose additional charges on disabled people if disabled individuals are requesting that documents be provided in an alternate form. All right, we basically have three types of board meetings. Oh, questions?
Is 72 hours considered a weekend or a
weekend? Yeah, it's 72 hours in advance of the board meeting, so it includes your weekends, which makes it sometimes challenging if you're on a holiday weekend and such, of when your board agenda needs to posted, but yeah, 72 hours is in a calendar week, not just business days. So we have three types of board meetings, generally. We've got regular meetings, and like we mentioned before, the agenda has to be conspicuously posted, continually, publicly accessible, and for at least 72 hours before the meeting, and it has to be posted on the website. And regular meetings, like we said, are established by your board policies, the times and dates of your meetings. Special meetings are a little bit different animal. Special meetings, your agenda has to be posted and mailed. You'll have media that has standing requests for agenda items. Those special meeting agendas have to be posted and mailed or delivered to the media at least 24 hours prior to the meeting, and they also have to be posted on the website. Emergency meetings. Very unique circumstances for emergency meetings, and we'll talk briefly about them, but those agendas have to be posted at least 1 hour prior to the meeting, unless there's a dire emergency, in which case it's as soon as possible. And you have to provide telephonic notice to the media in the event of emergency meetings. Extremely, extremely rare to have an emergency meeting.
Is a workshop study session considered a regular meeting?
Could be considered a regular meeting of the board if it's held at a regularly scheduled time for the board. So it could be encompassed as part of a regular meeting. The terminology doesn't necessarily make a difference, but usually at your regular meeting, you're going to conduct a variety of business of the district, and an informational meeting like this. This is the only thing that's on the agenda, so there's rules about what the public can comment about. At regular meetings, the public is able to comment during its public comment session about anything that's within the subject matter jurisdiction of that entity. So at a regular board meeting, you know, you might be talking only about certain things that are on the agenda, but if there's another concern that falls within the jurisdiction of the board, the public can comment on it at a regular board meeting. The same right doesn't apply at a special board meeting. At a special board meeting, people are limited to only being able to make comment about what's on the agenda for the special board meetings. So let's talk a little bit about special board meetings. Board meetings may,
Can you give us an example of what type of issue qualifies as emergency?
Yeah, I'll get, I have a slide on it. I promise I'll get to that. I'm gonna talk about the special board meetings first. Board meeting, the board can call a special board meeting only to consider the business that's specified in that agenda. So that's the only reason that you can, that's the only business you can conduct at a special board meeting, is what's on your agenda. You can have a closed session portion of your special board meeting if that's something that you need to do. We see that sometimes, you know, several years ago, districts were undergoing layoffs, and there were a lot of last minute special board meetings in order to be able to conduct all that business before certain March 15th deadlines occurred. So a lot of boards weren't able to conduct all their business at their regular meetings, and special meetings needed to be called in order to conduct that business. A special board meeting can be called either by the president of the board or majority of the board. And again, the notice has to be posted 24 hours in advance and delivered to the media and posted on the website. And the public must be heard. You still have to have a public comment session on your agenda, but it's limited to the items that are on the special agenda. And the recent legislation is you absolutely cannot call a special meeting regarding the salary schedules, or compensation paid in the form of fringe benefits of a district executive. So this kind of all arose out of the Bell situation. But if you're talking about your most high up superintendent, assistant superintendents, you can't have a special meeting to talk about their salaries or fringe benefits. That business has to be conducted at a regular meeting. On to your question about emergency meetings. This slide kind of covers what emergency meetings are. It's okay to hold an emergency meeting without the required 72-hour notice. The emergency meetings go on 1-hour notice, and they only happen where the emergency involves a disruption or threatened disruption of basically of public facilities. So the slide is kind of jumbled because there's two types of emergencies. There's regular emergencies and there's dire emergencies. So the regular emergencies on this chart right here are work stoppages is a regular emergency. Any crippling activity that just cripples your ability to conduct business at the district, or any other activity that severely impairs the public health or the safety as determined by the majority of the board. So those would be emergency meetings. Dire emergency meetings is any crippling disaster, you know, if we were to have a severe earthquake here or something that did some damage and affected our ability to conduct business. Mass destruction, terrorist act, threatened terrorist activity, anything that imposes immediate and significant peril such that we're willing to forego our 72-hour requirement under the Board Act and the 24-hour requirement for special board. We say it's such a dire emergency that we can't give you more than an hour's notice. It has to be that kind of an emergency. And again, you can have a closed session at that as well. The goal is to get the notice out then as quickly as possible. Yes?
A group meeting like this, even 1 hour, maybe too long.
It could be. I mean, but the requirement is 1 hour.
Any way around?
No, the minimum for a dire emergency is 1 hour.
Here's the tab for this life or death thing. So that one in 1 hour.
Well, you know, maybe for a dire emergency, because the emergency, well, no, it has to, in a dire emergency, yeah, that slide actually does show. Up in the left corner, 1 hour notice due to the, you have to provide 1 hour notice to the media unless it's a dire emergency. In a regular emergency, it's a 1 hour. Dire emergency, it's just as soon as you can get the notice out. It's by telephone to the media, and that's the requirement. Okay, how do you change an agenda? You posted the agenda, you know, it needs to be up for 72 hours. Phew, we got it up for the week. But now you need to change something. How do we do it? There's only limited circumstances where you can change an agenda. And the first one is if the majority of the board determines that an emergency exists pursuant to that last statute. So you can change the agenda then. You can change it if a two-thirds of the vote of the members present at a meeting determined that there's an action that needs to be taken immediately on an item that didn't come up until after the agenda was posted. So something, you know, you post your agenda, something critical happens, and you really need to take action. You can't wait until a special board meeting. You can't wait until your next regularly scheduled board meeting. You can change the agenda and take action on it at that board meeting, but it's going to take two-thirds vote of the members that are present at the meeting in order to modify that agenda. You can change the agenda after posting if the item was on a previous agenda and it was and the meeting got adjourned and it's reconvening within 5 days. In that case, you can change the agenda as well. If it doesn't meet one of these three exceptions for changing the agenda, you got to do 72-hour notice, or you have to call a special meeting, which means you need 24-hour notice, which isn't too bad. 24 hours isn't too bad.
I read somewhere that if the public wants to add something to the agenda before the posting, they have to do it within 7 days. Prior to the meeting.
I haven't seen that in the Brown Act. That might be something that is a matter of local policy for you. But what the law says about the public adding items to an agenda, the Brown Act really only goes so far as to say it encourages public participation in that manner, but it's not a ministerial duty. So just because a member of the public is asking us to place something on the public agenda doesn't mean that we have to place it on the agenda. It's at the discretion of the board to determine whether that's an item that should. But the Brown Act encourages the public to participate in that manner by requesting that items be placed on the agenda. It's just still within the discretion to determine. Yeah. Okay. Matter of fact, that's this next slide. Members of the public can be allowed to place matters directly related to the district business on the agenda. Members of the public must be able to address the board regarding items on the agenda before or during the governing board's consideration. So the Brown Act really, with respect to school districts, only envisions having one public comment period. So you can either have it before all your business of your district, or you can have a comment session when the items come up on the agenda. So it's different for community college districts. Community college districts have to provide the public the right to comment as the items come up on the agenda. So it's a little bit different there. Definitely that's what the Brown Act envisions for public participation. This is the only way the public is going to be able to chime in and give its opinion and say what it thinks about what you're considering about the business before the board. So that's why we need to make sure we have public public comment sessions during our
So he did it during the consideration of the item. If there's, say, 10 items, and the person wanted to speak on 5 of them, they can come up at 5 different times?
It is, it is a matter of the rule that you create as a board. First of all, as to when you want to have your public comment session, and then also providing reasonable restrictions on the public's right to comment. So maybe like it says, public is limited to 3 minutes comments on things. Those are things that are created by our boards and can be modified by our board for the efficiency of the board. So if you know you have 30 items on your agenda that night and that 5 of them are going to be really heated and you're expecting a lot of public participation that night, it's within the discretion of the board and your board rules, whatever your board rules say about how you govern this, to say, you know what, we usually have 3 minutes, but today we have so much on the agenda, we're going to limit everybody to 2 minutes. And that's within the discretion of the board to do. What the board can do is say, I'm going to allow you to talk about this subject, but I don't like what you have to say on this subject, so I'm not going to allow you to talk. You can't do a viewpoint discrimination of somebody's speech during a meeting. All you can do is adopt, well, and again, I'm ahead of myself. It's the next slide here. Every regular meeting, you have to have the opportunity for members of the public to address the board on any item of interest in the public within the subject matter of jurisdiction. Again, that's regular board meetings. Special board meetings only is limited to the agenda. When a member of the public makes a comment to the board, board members are limited in the ways that they are able to respond to the public. And these are the ways that you can respond. You can briefly respond to the statement made or a question posed by a commenter, okay? You can't engage in a heated discussion or debate with the person who's making the comment. You can ask questions for clarification, or you can make a brief announcement, you know, about it.
Did I miss a slide?
I'll comment on this one though. You can ask questions for clarification or make a brief announcement. You can provide reference to staff or other resources for factual information. You can request that the staff report back to the body at a later meeting, you know, to give you more information. Or you can direct staff to place a matter on a future agenda. The whole reason that we don't want to engage in a lot of discussion following a public comment is because you want to avoid developing a consensus regarding a matter without it being properly agenda. So you don't want, you know, you having a prolonged discussion or argument or something with a member of the public for a public comment that was made, you know, it's going to reveal your opinion. It's going to, you know, maybe help create a consensus regarding something before it's come up on the agenda.
What happens if they're commenting on an item that is on the agenda?
Again, you just don't want the goal is not to try and influence by virtue of the comment that's made. You know, you can speak your, allow them to speak their piece, but your deliberation as a board is a collective deliberation, and it takes place in front of the public. So you can soak in the comments, and as you're having your deliberation as a group with the board, that would be the appropriate time to, you know, address your concerns.
It's really a difficult situation because I know when I've been on the audience side, and you know, people depending on the subject matter can be very emotional about what they're talking about, and to sit there and not give them any type of feedback.
Isn't that interesting?
It's very frustrating.
And it can be very, for people who don't regularly attend board meetings, it can be kind of shocking to those
exactly.
people because they're saying, the board is sitting there, they're not doing it, saying anything in response, you know, so you have to wonder, but it really is the appropriate, you know, you have to look at the design of the meeting. The meeting is to really just conduct business of the district, and in order to do that, you know, the district of the business doesn't belong to the board, it belongs to the public, and so this is the only way for the public to be able to say something before you take the action to deliberate. So it's not supposed to be an open discussion between members of the public and the board. It's just supposed to be the public being able to have its say before, you know, the board members take their action that they've been charged with to conduct the business of the board. I mean, of the district. Okay. Public participation, some more. The board may adopt reasonable rules and regulations in order to ensure the proper functioning of the meeting. And this is going back to my last comment. The regulations have to be reasonable, they have to be content neutral with respect to, and they have to be time neutral, place neutral. So you can have time and placement and manner restrictions that you're imposing on everybody. But the key is to make sure that you're treating all public commenters equally. Make sure in your board policy that you're establishing what the maximum time limits are, but also give yourself the discretion to be able to make adjustments to those maximum time limits in the event that that's what's reasonable to do in the conduct of the business of your district, depending on how many items that you have coming up on your agenda or, you know, the type of item that's there. One of the keys to public participation is that we can't prohibit public criticism of the policies, the procedures, programs, services of the agency, or of the acts or omissions of the board or employees. And the reason for this mostly is because when we're in a board session, it's a limited public forum, and it's the only place where members of the public can come and make statements that are protected. And so they're able, there's no defamation inside a boardroom. And so the public has to be able to feel free to be able to make comments and make criticisms without the fear that they're going to get sued for their comments. And so that's why we can't prohibit these things when we are in our regular board meetings.
I have a question about time.
Yes.
You said that you could extend the time if we are allowed to.
Yes.
So if somebody comes up to speak and they want an extra minute, are we allowed to give that? Because I thought they're all equal.
Well, that's just it. You have to consider what's, I mean, if you're only going to allow one person to have extra time, then it's going to be the perception that not everybody is being treated equally. You might, I mean, it might be appropriate to extend time for certain issues. So if you know you have consent calendar items that aren't going to have much public comment or something, but you have a big issue or controversial issue that's coming up before the board, you might make an announcement ahead of time to say, we're going to follow our traditional time limits for these subjects, but for this subject, we're going to extend time to 5 minutes. It's a matter of importance to the board. And you can establish those kinds of reasons. But then everybody speaking on that subject needs to be treated the same. Yeah.
What is the maximum? What is the longest time limit have seen all boards?
No, I can't even comment. There's been some times that I've been at board meetings where people have been allowed to speak 5 or 6 minutes. And it depends sometimes on how many people have come to the board meeting and the relative importance. I remember a very controversial issue at a community college district, and a lot of people from the public came, but there was a limited number of people that wanted to speak, and it was such an important subject that they gave each of them about 8 minutes to speak on the subject because they knew that the rest of the public wasn't going to. So it's difficult to open a meeting like that because then what if there are 50 people and they all want to speak, and then you have to be cognizant of how late your board meeting is going to run, and then is that a benefit to be running your board meeting into 11:30 at night? You know, if other members of the public are attending your meeting and they really want to see item number 24 out of 25 on your calendar, but now it's 11:30 at night, they might be discouraged from staying. So part of the goals in limiting public comments is to be able to manage your meeting so that you maximize the public participation in your meeting. People who want to be there don't feel like, gosh, these meetings last 5 hours every time I'm here, it's not worth it for me to come. You want them to be encouraged to attend meetings.
You know, I've seen it like when this room is packed, uh-huh. and there's 30 people that want to speak. Can you say for this subject matter, we're going to give you 10 minutes, and you can pick whoever you want to speak for those 10 minutes?
Not recommended, not recommended.
Yes. How is the board to have these kinds of conversations about limiting time without it being considered a meeting or a ceremony?
You do it at the opening of the meeting. You can do that at the opening of the meeting.
So close to Jen.
Yes. When you open your meeting and you're going to announce, this is how we're going to deal with business today. We're going to have this many minutes for something. And is that truly at the discretion? Well, look at your board bylaws, but it's generally at the discretion of the board president to determine how they're going to manage the meeting and those types of decisions. Okay, meeting practices. Minutes have to be taken. Recording all the actions that are taken at a governing board meeting. The minutes are public records. There's no format that you have to follow for your minutes. It's not mandated in the Brown Act. The Brown Act just says that you have to have minutes. The goal here is making sure that you're not taking any action by secret ballot. And then most recently, I think this was a 2012 edition, for public session items, the boards have to publicly report by roll call vote now any action that's taken. So voting, abstention, each member of the board that's present, you have to do a roll call vote on your actions during your meetings. Any person that attends a meeting has the right to record the meeting by still or motion picture camera, by video or audio tape, unless the board finds that there's a persistent disruption of the proceedings, in which case they can decide that taping has to cease. Teleconferencing is a new way to join a meeting. Teleconference meetings are permitted, but they have to comply with all of the requirements of the Brown Act. So all votes during a teleconference meeting have to be done by roll call. There's some rules about agendizing a meeting when it's going to be, it's going to be by teleconference. You have to post the agenda at each teleconference location. So if somebody says, I can't be physically at the meeting, but I'm going to teleconference from my home, well, then you got to post the agenda at your home, and you have to open up your home to anybody who wants to come and publicly participate from that teleconference location. So you you have to be cognizant of it. It's not like at work where we get to work from home and just, you know, call it in. We have to post an agenda at each location. You have to identify the location of where each person that's participating by teleconference is going to be. And all of those places have to be accessible by the public. And since you have to follow the rules of the Brown Act, it has to be ADA compliant as well. If somebody needed to be accommodated, that location also has to do that accommodation. Of course, whenever you're having teleconferencing, it doesn't mean everybody can call it in that day. The quorum or majority of the board members have to participate within the boundaries of the district. Question?
Can the location be foreign country?
Can the location be a foreign country? I suppose conceivably, yes, as long as a majority of the members are within, you know, participating within the forum. The thing is, you have to post an agenda there. You have to make it accessible to the public. And, it, you know, it might be determined to be unreasonable. You know, some of these are spacious arguments, but it might be determined to be unreasonable to have a teleconference from that location. But it also might be an advantage to the district to be able to have your participation that otherwise you wouldn't be able to have because you're out of town. Okay, the agenda has to provide the an opportunity for the public to address the board directly from each teleconference location. So you've got people that are at your house because you're having it from your house, then they have to have the ability to participate by public comment so that everybody in the other locations can hear their comments as well.
Back to the roll call, you don't have to do roll call vote each time you run on something.
Yes, it's a roll call vote every time you take an action.
You don't all like five say yes. You know,
when it's 5-0,
unanimous decisions, you don't. If it's a unanimous decision, it's okay.
Only when it's like a 4-1 or whatever.
Right, then you have to do roll call. Okay.
Our minutes reflect roll call because when it's 5-0, it's a roll call.
Okay.
Over some of the abstains or votes no, it is done by roll call.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about closed session. And I've put these in detail in your slides, but I don't think that we necessarily have to go over the details. I just wanted to give you slides that if you have any of these situations that come up for closed session, you'll know generally what's required in order to bring the matter into closed session and generally how to agendize those matters because there's safe harbor provisions that are listed. In your outline that I provided, the bigger, more comprehensive document, as you go through pages 24 to 41, which has to do with closed sessions, you'll specifically see the agenda, how to agendize all of the closed session exemptions. There are samples that are listed in there, the safe harbor provisions. Also, if you all have your handy dandy board member Brown Act books, those will also list them out. The safe harbor provisions were actually adopted by the legislature, so they're listed in statute, and so they're easy to locate whenever you have these types of matters to agendize. So our most common types of closed sessions, things that that we're able to pull things out of the public view and do some of our deliberations and actions in a closed session outside the public view. There's very limited exceptions, and these are the most commonly used ones. Discussion of existing or existing or anticipated litigation. So you want to talk with your attorney. You know, there's a threat of a lawsuit against the district, or you're in the middle of an administrative hearing, or somebody filed a discrimination complaint with the EEOC. Any of those types of things, you are able to agendize for closed session and have discussion and get advice from legal counsel in your closed session. Consulting with a labor negotiator, you want to be able to give direction to your negotiation team as to your desires for settling a contract, a labor contract negotiation. You can meet with your labor negotiators in closed session. Same with real property negotiators. You can meet with real property negotiators in closed session. All individual personnel matters, employee discipline, dismissal, release, consideration of evaluation of employee, all these things can be done in closed session so long as you're dealing with an individual personnel matter. You're not trying to deal with all of them. Student discipline matters also can be conducted in closed session. And then if there's threats to public safety or you're talking about the development of your your safety response plan, things like that, can, that you can have some forms of discussion in closed session about those items. Right, there's student discipline matters. They're allowed to be in closed session unless the student requests that they be heard in a public session. But a lot of times, in most of the cases, people don't want them necessarily heard in public session. Remember that what happens in closed session is not necessarily or entirely secret. The topics that you're putting that you're going to discuss in closed session have to be listed on your agenda. So you're going to have a part of your agenda that says closed session. It's going to list generally, with those safe harbor provision indicators on the agenda, what you're going to talk about in closed session. And actions that you take in closed session ultimately have to be reported out into the open public session. So you'll conduct business in closed session. Let's say you enter into a settlement agreement, you agree to settle something, or you agree to pursue litigation somewhere. When you go back into your open session, you're going to have to report out what happened in closed session. You know, the board took action to initiate litigation in such and such a matter. Or you might not even have to report what the matter is yet, because it might impact your ability to serve the person or something. So there's just a reporting out requirement. The public is entitled to know what actions that you took in closed session. They're not necessarily entitled to all the details, but they're entitled to certain reports.
Do they need to know the vote on it?
It just depends. Every action that goes into closed session has specific rules that are treated differently about what you need to report out. So it just depends.
Why do we need closed session? The topic often asks us, why do we have closed session? We close the door. And my question is, if we have no closed session, what will happen? Who will be damaged? I obviously, if we have no closed session, students' name or students' issue will be then students' damaged. And what happens to the
motor? Sure, there's a lot of situations why we bring it in. It's generally if it's going to impair the ability of the district to take an action. So for instance, if we didn't have a closed session with our attorney about litigation, it might impact our ability to settle a case. It might impact our ability to sue somebody because they're going to know that they're going to get served with something and they will run for the district. It might impact our ability to negotiate a good deal when we're trying to buy property or sell property. If we're disclosing all those terms in the public, then, you know, we might not be able to get the best deal. Same with, you know, personnel matters. There's some privacy considerations with respect to your employment. You know, it's okay for the public to ultimately know we released a certificated teacher, but it's not necessarily okay for us to disclose the name, the particular name of the person. There's just some actions that lend themselves to either privacy considerations or would impair our ability to do good business for the district. And that's why we have the ability to consider them in closed session. There is a duty of closed session confidentiality, and I can't tell you how many boards I have dealt with not to talk about it in public. You have an obligation not to talk about it with your spouse. You have an obligation not to discuss what occurred in closed session. And people kind of treat this lightly, and they go out into the public, or, you know, things get out that we all know should only have occurred in closed session. There's no way anybody else would know about it. And then when we hear things happening outside in the public, and it constitutes a leak. So you have to know that you have a duty of confidentiality with respect to closed session matters. Any person who attends closed session. So if you have your attorney that comes in, invited as a guest into closed session to discuss something, they have an obligation not to discuss closed session matters. If you have a member of staff that's coming in because they're a necessary person to discuss a discipline matter or something, they have an obligation not to publicly disclose the confidential information. It includes any communication that was made during the closed session that relates to the business of the district. There are some exceptions. They're stated in the law. You know, it's okay for you to disclose with the district attorney or the grand jury certain conversations that happen in closed session. There's whistleblower statutes. So there's certain statutes that allow us to break that trust. But the real rule is don't talk about anything that occurred in closed session. That's why we bring it into closed session, is because it's so important that we need it to be confidential until the matter is completed. The public is going to get a report out eventually. It's just at the time, until that time happens, we cannot talk about what happens in closed session.
Do you invite the guest to the closed session? Is there a guideline who is authorized to invite guests, or can any board member invite guests, or has it been?
No, there's no particular guidelines. The Brown Act doesn't say only these people can be in closed session or these people can't be in closed session. The general rule is that they have to have a specific purpose to whatever business that you're conducting in closed session. So we don't invite people in just to watch, you know, see what closed session is like. If you're, for instance, if it's negotiations, you're going to invite members of the negotiating team who need to hear specifically from the board. And again, the discretion lies with the board. And I don't know if you guys have particular board bylaws that actually talk about who can go into closed session, but it really lies at the discretion of the board to determine who is necessary and relevant to whatever that business item is that you're conducting in closed session.
So who determines is?
It generally, ultimately, lies with the. It should be a collectively derived, but ultimately, it rides with the board president to make determinations about how, you know, the business is going to be run and who would be important to further the business of the district.
In no normal situation, fine, but sometimes if the board member or any one board may intentionally invite the guest.
Yeah, well, people, yes.
It would also depend upon the agenda, what's agendized for closed session, and
correct.
Who we need to.
It has to be somebody necessary.
On that agenda for closed session.
It can't just be somebody that you want to have come and watch. It has to be somebody who's necessary for furtherance of that particular bit of business. And there's some reporting requirements, you know, on the agenda. Like, for instance, if it's for negotiations, you have to list the name of the negotiator. Who's the negotiator that you're inviting into closed session? The public's entitled to know the name. So there's rules depending on what the closed session item is. But as a general rule, it's only going to be people that have business being there. Okay. So let's just talk real quickly. I just wanted to go through a couple of the closed session exceptions. These are reasons that you can be in closed session. If there's a threat to public safety, these are the rules. You can hold a closed session with the attorney general, district attorney. But your closed session, again, it's not unlimited. It's only limited to matters posing a threat to the security of the public buildings, threat to security of essential public services, threat to the public's right to access. This is a really rarely used exception that would bring you into the closed session. This is one we use all the time, is the personnel exception. This allows you to meet in closed session to consider the appointment, employment, evaluation, discipline, or dismissal of an employee. And when we say consider, when Brown Act uses the word consider, it means discuss or take action upon. It means both, either or both. Again, it has to be related to the particular individual. If a matter is brought into closed session, like there's a recommendation to dismiss an employee, and ultimately you decide, no, we're not going to follow that recommendation, we're not going to dismiss that employee, nothing has to be reported out after that closed session, because you didn't take any, it's not considered taking any action, it's inaction, so it doesn't need to be reported out. You're able to use closed session to consider complaints or charges that are brought against a public employee. So somebody, a member of the public comes in, I want to complain about a teacher, I've got a formal complaint I want to make about this particular employee. We can bring that kind of a matter into closed session, but with regard to things that are charges or complaints, we have to give that employee a 24-hour Brown Act notice. So 24 hours before the meeting, we have to tell them that this is going to be held in closed session, but if you don't want us to hold it in closed session, you have the right to ask us to hold it in the public open session of the meeting, and we're obligated to do that. It doesn't work in reverse. It doesn't work where you say, hey, we're going to have this meeting out in the public, and the employee says, no, I don't want the public to hear it. I want it to be in closed session. They don't have the right to say that. They only have the right to take it out of closed session and make it heard in an open session. And some people do, and most people don't. non-reelection of people, that's not considered a complaint. Even though the reason that you're probably non-reelecting the probationary employee is because they're not performing satisfactorily, which could be regarded as a complaint, but under the Brown Act and the statute, or in the case law that interprets it, non-reelection of probationary employees is not considered a complaint or a charge, and so therefore, you do not have to give the employee a 24-hour Brown Act notice. I'm not going to go through all these because I think I've sufficiently covered them in the slides to be able to say that these are the exceptions. Litigation advice from legal counsel, if you have anticipated or you're in the middle of litigation, these are the rules that you would have to follow as far as who can be in closed session, what you can talk about in closed session on this matter, and then any reporting out requirements. When you settle a matter, these are the rules regarding settlements. You can approve you can approve a settlement agreement in closed session, but you're going to have to report it out into the open as well, into the open session. Student discipline, you can do that in closed session unless they request it to be in open. Labor negotiations, we already talked about what you can do as far as discussing labor negotiations. Once you're reaching an agreement, when you reach a final agreement, you can't do that in closed session. Ultimately, the ratification and everything needs to be in open session. Employment contracts, when you're talking about your executives like the superintendent or deputies, anybody of that level, those contracts have to be ratified in open session. You can't do those in closed session. You can talk about it in closed session, but it has to be ratified in the open session. And then, of course, the contracts are public, and so anybody who requests it can request it. Real property transactions, these are, again, things that you can do in closed session within the limitations that are specified on these slides. And then there's some other less used authorities for closed sessions that are also addressed in the Brown Act. The safe harbor provisions, like I mentioned, are listed in statute, and again, the goal is to give that description to the public so that they know what you're talking about. And, you know, they have a general idea of what's going on in closed session so that in the public's comment session before you adjourn the closed session, they can make any comments that they want based on the agenda item that that you posted for closed session. In these next couple of slides, I just replicated what was sort of in the outline and pulled a couple of the types of closed session items, and this is what your agenda would look like. It would just say, conference with real property negotiators. Then in bold, you're gonna say, here's the property. You're gonna give either the address or the parcel number. You're gonna say who the district's negotiator is. You're gonna say who the parties are the district's negotiating with. And then you're not gonna talk about the specific terms, but you're gonna say, these are items that, you know, that we're gonna talk about. We're gonna talk about price, we're gonna talk about terms, and so that the public has an idea of what's going on in closed session. So these slides give a few more examples of safe harbor provisions. Prior to the closed session, you have to read, you know, or refer the public to the agenda as, you know, make an announcement that you're going into closed session and here's the items that we're going to be looking at. And then after the closed session, you have to reconvene in open and report out any actions that you took. You can do this either orally or you can do it in writing. And then any actions that you took that have final actions, they have to be available the next business day, unless there's a bunch of amendments that are going on and then it's within a reasonable time. What kind of penalties can you face if you violate the Brown Act? Well, there's criminal penalties, and that's the most significant thing. You can be guilty of a misdemeanor if you take action that's in violation of the Brown Act, and but they have to be able to show this in trying to bring criminal penalties against you, that you intended to deprive the public of some sort of information that the public's entitled to. That's the whole purpose of the Brown Act, trying to prevent. And so if they can prove that, and there was a violation of the Brown Act, you might be guilty of a misdemeanor. You can't make confidential reports. Or talk about things that occurred in closed session. These are the confidentiality provisions, your obligation to keep closed session items confidential. There's also civil penalties on top of the criminal penalties. This is when, you know, maybe you engaged in some action and it wasn't properly agendized. Some of the civil penalties, if somebody were to file an action, would be a potential invalidation of the board action. There could be attorney's fees for somebody who enforces the Brown Act rights, points out your violation. If you don't cure it and correct it, they might be entitled to attorney's fees if they win in court. And then we have something called injunction or declaratory relief. Sometimes members, interested members who sue boards regarding the Brown Act are doing it not because they want something out of it, but they just want you to either follow the procedures like you're supposed to, in which case they're asking for declaratory relief. Like, we want to make sure that this is how the board is supposed to handle stuff, so we're going to court to have a court tell us what we're supposed to do. Or it might be to prevent the board from doing something that they've repeatedly violated and not corrected, and we're asking them to stop the violations. So you can go through these slides. These are just the slides about the remedies, and really there's a timeline. There's actions that have to be taken. Somebody can't just run to court and sue a board for violations of the Board Act. They have responsibilities as well. They have to give written notification to the board that we believe there's been a Brown Act violation, and give the board the opportunity to cure and correct it before they go to court. So these slides just sort of describe, you know, those timelines for what needs to be done in the event that there's a violation, so that the board can have the opportunity to correct it. And those are more timelines. Sometimes the Brown Act allows a district attorney to come in, or any interested party to file an action to determine whether something that the board did in the past is a violation of the Brown Act. So they're asking for some sort of declaratory relief to say, is what the board did wrong? I want to know. I can't seem to work it out with the board. And that's something that they can do under the Brown Act as well. And I think that's about it. If you have, I mean, we do a half day, full day workshops on the Brown Act, so if this taste wasn't enough for you, and you want to get even more in depth, we have those types of sessions as well. I just wanted to make sure that you were aware of them. So are there any other questions that I might be able to address or answer for you?
Good job.
Well, thank you. I hope you feel better informed, not so nervous about Brown Act stuff, but just try and keep things separate. Just always imagine a column between you and the board member or a commission member sitting next to you. We don't want to have those deliberations. And just, you know, encourage the public to participate, and I think everybody will be fine. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Well, I need a motion to bring a citizen on Oversight Committee.
Oh, feel free. It doesn't matter what order. Go for it.
Okay, you went first, we went last.
We'll let you in.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Can you get first?
First.
5:59.
Same.
Who's the first?
You
made the motion.
Carla.
Go for it.
For the governing board, may I get a motion to adjourn? Okay, we have first by Donna Friedman.
Second
by Lynn Ebbingham. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. 5:57. Yes.
Did you get the whole thing?
Yeah, my battery did real well this time.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, got the whole enchilada here, yeah. But you know something, you guys need to be mic'd up or so that it goes to the PA system, because you know, you're talking that way and the sound.
So you didn't hear.
Not as well, but I have to do, go back and enhance the stuff, you know. It just makes things go a bit better.
Thank you for saving me water.
I'm videotaping. I see a conspiracy here.
How are you doing? Happy New Year. Good to see you.
I think you have that 9:30.
Yeah.
I can find out.
John, you have to get it somewhere
else. No, he's close to it.
Good. Thank you.
Feel free to eat our. Good.